Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Token Post interview. I am here joined by Mr. Bernardo Bright, the head of partnership at Transfer Swiss. Welcome, sir.
Thank you.
So before we get on the interview, you're here at Pyeongchang. Mm-hmm. Now, how are you feeling?
Well, I love the fact that it's a ski resort, right?
It's the first time, yeah.
Yeah. So I would say that, it's a great conference, but at the same time, you know, I can ski after the conference. So yeah, I love the fact. It's great, just great.
Now diving into the interview, Transfer Swiss is a crypto fund investment company, right? So could you give a brief introduction about what your company does and the services that you guys provide?
Definitely. So Transfero currently has around $60 million under management. So right. We have invested in several ICO projects. Only after the ICO is done, though. I will get to that later. We also have the biggest OTC trading desk out of Brazil. So it's very peculiar. I would say the OTC business in Brazil is growing. And we also have the exchange listing business, where we have listed more than 80 projects so far. Mm-hmm. And we basically help projects get to Binance, Huobi, OKX, and all those big ones. So
the Transfer Swiss provides, like you said, the biggest, the OTC trading desk in Brazil, right?
Yeah.
But then the company's name is Transfer Swiss.
Yeah.
What's the story behind there?
Okay, that's a great question, actually. So in Brazil, it was kind of a gray area, just like in Korea for some time. Mm-hmm. And Switzerland, it has been very proactive in regulating crypto. So I would say that our main choice behind building the company in Switzerland, because all our partners are Brazilians, was that they are pretty crypto-friendly. So I would say that it was a good choice, even now, because we actually helped layer the whole regulation scene in Brazil for crypto. And getting like the example from the Switzerland government and FEMA and so on, it was actually a good experience for us. So I would say that it's a much more friendly regulation.
But how's the vibe there compared to Korea? I mean, when the crypto hype, they'd say?
Okay, yeah. I mean, Zug, the crypto valley, it has a lot of companies, but I would say it's more of a jurisdiction thing. Mm-hmm. So Korea, you have all the hype and the craziness and many events full, although, you know, Switzerland, not so much. So
right.
I would say that things close early, for example, in Zug. So you can't really have a bar or restaurants until after 10. Mm-hmm. And although you have like Crypto Valley Association and other like organizations there, I would say Korea is much further ahead.
Mm-hmm. Now, diving into the services provided by Transfer Swiss, when it comes to ICO, the market seems to be a bit of in a bear trend compared to last year. So, specifically for Transfer Swiss, what are the services that you guys provide as a consultant, as well as your prediction on the ICO market especially?
Of course, yeah. So, we provide the exchange listing business, as I mentioned. We also outsource a lot of services, so marketing, roadshows, community building, and also even mark making. Mm-hmm. So we have big partners like FBG, BitGosu, and many others from Korea for marketing and so on. So I would say that we provide the whole set. We like to be a one-stop shop. Mm-hmm. And the things we don't do the best, for example, mark making, we like to have partners that do so that we can actually provide the full support for the projects we work with. And regarding the ICO market?
Yes, the ICO trend.
So I would say that the ICO trends usually follows the whole market, right? Mm-hmm. So now we are in bear market, so the ICO market follows. And when we have the bull market again, I think the trend will go up again, even though a share of that will be STOs. But also, I would say that a lot of the people that say, ICO is dead and so on.
Yeah.
It's not there yet. I would say that there's a lot of action going, but it's actually a good thing that we had the bear market, because we get rid of all the bad players, or most of them, and the bad practices as well. So you get much more reliable players in the space. So.
Now, you mentioned an interesting concept, STOs, right?
Yeah.
However, when it comes to the legal compliance of STOs, the countries, the public, they're divisive, which means that there's a lot of controversy going over it. So what's your take on STOs especially?
Yeah. I think that there's a lot of developments to be seen in the STO space. I think a lot of countries that are more crypto-friendly are trying to fight over the STOs to like grab investments and grab some cash flow into
Indeed,
the country,
right?
So I think that Singapore should be a good player in the STO space. Hong Kong, with the equivalence of the SEC in Hong Kong, should be interesting. And also Switzerland, because they have been in the ICO space for a while. So I think they would be a good jurisdiction that you can make a good compliance STO. So.
How's the legal compliance of STOs in Switzerland then?
Yeah, so it's pretty crypto friendly. I would say they are doing a lot of sandbox and they are laying the grounds for the wave of STOs to come. So
yes.
I think that end of 2018, we'll see the most STOs to come. Because I would say that's too early for it to actually mirror the whole ICO boom.
Yes.
So as long as we have at least five good compliance jurisdictions, then I think we could see a good tokenization of securities.
Now, switching gears to another topic, which is exchange listing.
Yeah.
It's something that goes behind the scene, right?
Of course.
So from the perspective of crypto funds, what do you guys provide, and what's the story behind each listing?
Yeah, definitely.
I mean, I'm pretty sure you can't like speak out the specifics, but
no,
the
right.
generally, right?
So I would say that a lot of the details that the average Joe or someone that invests in crypto doesn't know is that usually projects pay for listings, and if they don't, they are pretty good or they have something to offer the exchange. In exchange, right? So basically, I would say that they either have like a huge community that they watch the exchange, or they have a good project and it's actually outstanding and goes beyond the average, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we have partnerships with over 90 exchanges from the top 100, so almost all the top 100. Right? And what we do is that usually we get rid of the whole hassle of getting in touch with the exchanges, because usually when you send an email
to the contact, it takes like 2 or 3 months, right?
Yeah. To get an answer, and then for the whole process, it could take up to a year, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what we do is that we shorten this whole process to 3 days or even like a week in the case of Binance, Huobi, and big exchanges. But we also try to get like the price lowered, and not really lowered, because the exchange wouldn't
They won't agree to it.
Yeah. But I would say that's the fair price, because a lot of the exchanges, they give the first quotes like super high, and then they get like that ping pong negotiation game.
Yes.
And what we do is that, okay, we already did the rating on the project, so we already know how good the project is. So we try to get to the fair price at ASAP, right?
Mm-hmm.
So usually our listings, they are good for the exchange and also good for the projects, because the exchange lists faster and also
much
more
cheaper.
Projects. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But like the volume is it's good, and also the whole process getting expedited, it's something that they are interested on. And for the projects, they pay less, they get listed faster, and they have a more broad option of exchanges, because we can actually give advice to them on which is the good one for them, which region to cover, and so on.
Now, when it comes to exchange listings, each exchange has their own unique regional criteria.
Definitely.
Now, for the sake of Transfero Swiss, what's the standard that you guys impose on projects, or the value that you guys see most, that you guys tend to put most weight on?
Of course. So I would say that for investing, what I said I would get to later. We haven't invested in any projects before the ICO was done, and usually we wait for 2 or 3 months so that we can actually see that the project's legit and that they didn't, you know, run away with the money or things like that. And also if they are actually building a product, because most ICOs, they raise money, they get 30 million, and then they don't, why do they have to bother?
Like 10 million for a white paper, right?
Yeah, if they already raised so much money. I mean, they just get it pushed with their belly, right? So I would say that something we really look at is their team and their whole commitments. We like to know them in person as well. Mm-hmm. But for listings, I would say that we do a very good background check on the project and also make sure that they aren't a scam and make the best possible effort to actually get a quality project through the exchange. So that's something that they love as well, because mm-hmm. they get so many forms, like 1,000 forms per week. And yeah, yeah. most of them are either scams or you know, projects that aren't that good of upper projects, right? So when we get the projects filtered mm-hmm. To the exchange, they love it, because then they just have to do like a quick mm-hmm. check rather than a long one mm-hmm. and just get it listed. So
now there are a number of topics or points that people look into when they review it, a project. So generally, the team maybe, the roadmap, or the technology. So what do you tend to put most weight on personally?
Definitely. So I would say that something that exchanges do and most people don't know is that they check the community mm-hmm. and not really, this has 50,000 members.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It's more like, okay, let's go to the group, stay 1 week there, see the activity. Because some groups, they have 50,000 people, but they
don't. No one talks?
No one talks. Or when people talk, they say, how did I get added to this group? Who put me here? And
yes, yes.
Like, F you and those things. So so they really look into it. Something that we personally look at is the technology mm-hmm. and the whole the roadmap and the whole product behind it. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of projects actually have a good product that is already like on testnet, and that's already you can take a grasp of what it will be when mainnet is released.
Indeed,
yes. And also something that we really like is real use cases from companies that were already established mm-hmm. but pivoting to blockchain. So let's say an app with messaging mm-hmm. like Telegram, for example. They're doing an ICO now mm-hmm. and a BitTorrent and so on.
Yes.
That's interesting, because then you get a real use application and you pivot it to blockchain and add features to it.
You already have a user base, right? So it's going to be much easier for them to establish their services. Yes. So now, moving on to the final question of the interview. We are at the beginning of 2019, and 2018 was a rough year for crypto traders. So with the Chinese New Year coming along, do you see a bullish market trend coming up in a few weeks or in a few months?
Yes.
Right to the point, I love it.
Yeah, I don't know if on the more short term mm-hmm. or more midterm, but mm-hmm. I think that 2019 should be a good year for crypto. Mm-hmm. We have so many good things coming up. We have BACT, we have also the halving mm-hmm. coming up shortly.
Yes.
And I think that with getting rid of the projects that don't really add value, you keep getting the whole network mm-hmm. stronger, and the crypto events, the quality has risen so much. Mm-hmm. I mean, before we were approached by a lot of projects like shitcoins, really, that were trying to pitch like their projects and so on.
Yes,
and I actually went to like Binance conference now, and CZ actually said, there aren't many projects, but the projects that are here are very good quality. Mm-hmm. So that's a good thing as well, because then you don't have to like waste time with bad players, and you can actually focus on building more and doing better partnerships as well.
So stronger will survive, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Well, that is all the questions we have today. Thanks so much for your time.
Awesome. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for tuning in. That was Mr. Bernardo Brights, the head of partnership at Transfero Suisse.